I guess it started with Dreaming Chamber, an installation I did for the Third Asia Pacific Triennial at the Art Gallery, Queensland Art Gallery, back in 1991. And it was also around the time when I started to use the rear-lit earth-printed fabric. And Dreaming Chamber was actually a room comprised of a number of these fabric screens surrounding a pool of water in a room. And it was this kind of evolving sequence that started in total darkness, then introduced rear and front lighting, sound, smell, and these synchronized water ripples. It had this really evocative atmospheric soundtrack with Papua New Guinea Highland flute, and that kind of took people on this kind of immersive sensory journey. You know, my intention was to try and create this really deeply meditative experience that would allow people to kind of momentarily transcend time, to completely be absorbed in the moment, kind of go into their dreaming, so to speak. But the word dreaming itself wasn't specifically intended as a reference to Aboriginal dreaming. It was referring more to a state of mind and a sense of kind of stepping outside of our normal everyday awareness. Well, when I met my technical collaborator and my global mind partner, Harry Sokol, I initially kind of wanted him to design something that could generate water ripples and lighting effects controlled by brainwaves, because I wanted to kind of animate the Dreaming Chamber and similar future installations actually with my mind. I also kind of thought it might act as some scientific validation for my ideas around transference of mind states from artist to audience as something I'd been thinking about playing with for a while. But somewhere along the line, this project became an audiovisual animation software instead, partly really for practical reasons, I guess. But VizEgg is what actually came out of this, and how VizEgg actually works is it's a video effects toolkit. We create various programmable effects that can be controlled by EEG data. And the source image material is generally my own work, that being either imagery from my early prints and paintings and things like that, and video. And sometimes we can actually use live video. So the parameters that we set in the software manipulate this imagery by way of actual brainwave data. So, yep. Well, Dream Zone was really, in a way, a follow-on from Dreaming Chamber, but many years later, of course. It was a generative installation that was shown at GOMA in 2012, and that actually used my pre-recorded theta brainwaves, which I actually recorded while I was watching my mind generating them. So it was essentially a neurofeedback process. The theta brainwaves are associated with the dream state and kind of heighten states of creativity and inspiration, or the flow state that artists and musicians refer to. Being in the zone, whatever you want to call it. And the kaleidoscopic like pattern in Dream Zone was multiply mapped to create a kind of honeycomb like effect with all these interconnected hexagonal forms. And I guess much of my work really is about interconnection, whether that be through imagery or my process itself, or by connecting via our minds, whatever, you know. I kind of prefer to highlight the idea of oneness as opposed to separateness. That's kind of where I'm coming from. My kind of perfect example might be a sculpture I did for the Limpress Sculpture Award some years back. It was a mirror DNA sculpture called Codex, and that sort of seemed to be a perfect example, because people on opposite side of the sculpture could kind of have fun merging in and out of each other and in and out of the surrounding landscape. And, conceptually I was acknowledging, I guess, both our uniqueness and individuality, but at the same time kind of highlighting our connectedness. That's the message behind much of my work, really.